Dear Fyil, February 1989, channeled writings by Kim and her spirit guide Fyil. This video will explain a lot about the soul interchange experience, and it also offers support toward a true story. Warning, some areas may be a little graphic.
Hi all. Listen, I'm going to try to get this one out too. It's part of my true story, but I was only going to do little excerpts of it, but after I started reading this again, I thought this is so profound, especially from a woman that did this that had hardly had any mind training. This is channeled writing. What this means is that with the help of her spirit guide, she channeled emotions and thoughts off the universe and wrote this story down for me after just having a little bit of class with me. Now, she hadn't been a prior student of mine. She came to my house to hear the story of me channeling the story of Christ. Now, at that point, a year later, I asked some students to come back. I had called her too, and she was definitely interested in taking the classes, and she became one of my most supportive students, friends, imaginable. The second night of support group and class, I said, go home and next week bring me the channeled writings from your guides of what happened since Bui'aid Mordecai's departure. I want you to take your time. I want accuracy. I haven't told you a lot of things because of the importance of this mission. Your guides are to tell you. The following week, I received this from Kim, the newest. We had only been in each other's presence three, maybe four times. The least trained member of the group brought me the most. I nearly cried from relief. I had help. There was a connection. Channeling with the help of a spirit guide worked. I got my support. Even though the pain attack continued daily, I had hope. So here it is, dear Fyil. I'm at lunch. This is about the only time we'll have to write, but this we need to do, my assignment. The life history of Mordecai within the last year and a half. You know this case history. I only know what Charlene has told me. He was in two bodies, the first of a heart attack victim who left when he entered and took the body. Then another heart attack took him away just after his amnesia and his soul was starting to understand. Then another who was spiritually awake, a Bill somebody, Peterson, who had a shady past that caused great difficulties in transformation. We know he was a homosexual, on drugs with money, molested as a child, 3, and had cut off his penis and had to have it sewn on as a child, 7, but psychically aware. And I know that was getting a little graphic, but you have to know the whole story about what was going on with this person. Then Mordecai was taken to a hold. I believe in the Pleiades for mourning or healing. Now you take over. Well, Kim, from the beginning, and this is Fyil now talking to her, it was Bui'aid and Charlene, unhappy with her marriage, who wanted to be together, to share happiness together. It is not a crime to wish well for yourself. They love each other with an eternal love, not a love of this world. This is quite obvious. Because of the intensity of Charlene's unhappiness, Bui'aid wished to make her happy, the knight in shining armor, and has now gone to war. She is a prize and quite worth it. He arranged for the soul transfer. Arrangements were made with Charlene. Plan Bs were set up and Cs. Everything was in order. The heart attack, which was already written into the first soul, we'll call him Bob, took place in Bui'aid's set up residence. The body survived, but much pain was involved. The body's density weighs heavy on the soul, and the big picture was forgotten in order to save the man's life. Once the healing had taken effect, memories took time to recall. Let's finish later. It's time for you to return to business. And, of course, Kim says, thank you. Then Kim picks up again. She goes, okay, Fyil, where did we leave off? Bui'aid Bob was getting well and then spent energies on soul remembrance to take over. All right. He began to remember who he was in bits and pieces. It would have been okay except for the bored souls who wanted something to play with. And this was the perfect toy. Here was someone substantial who could make great changes in their otherwise comfortable situations. Not exactly a threat, but an inconvenience, you may say. They each had pretty little thrones set up for themselves, and rather than let someone else set up a throne of their own, Huyai, Bob, and Charlene, they tore it down. They intercepted many of the transmissions and canceled them, so the thoughts could not be received. Then the transmissions came on harder, stronger, many, many of them. They were intense, coming from Charlene and her friends. They shot like arrows for the target, Huyai, Bob, and created quite a challenge for the opponent. Opponent's names were withheld by the channeler's request. You see, they are not evil, just bored. They were having a great time playing this game. It was a challenge for them. They see no harm in it. Life goes on and on and on. More and more aware or enlightened, and I do not care for this term at this time as the souls are more endarkened than lightened, but you understand the spiritual undertone. But there was pain and grief on both sides, actually. You get what you give. To continue, more of these people became involved in this war game. Bebop received mortal wounds. Of course, his heart, as it was his heart that hurt. He is quite strong, but just as he began to know and understand himself, he also carried with him the intense love spelled very large for all, not only for Charlene, but for those who tried to hurt and kill him. The wounds pained his heart to death. Had he received love from those he cared so much for, he would have lived many, many wonderful years. But it is not him to hate. Now for Charlene. She is very strong. She knows well the sting of pain, and she is a fighter. She does not stand back and let evil reside. So she gathers her troops, all of her friends and knowledgeable ones, and sends arrows of messages to Bebop. It would have been better if she had stood back and watched to see who was doing what. Why these messages were not being received. She did later, and then had to confront the enemy after the arrows had been shot. It is a matter of opinion that dialogue beforehand is better than combat of arms. Charlene was not aware, however, who, what, when, where, and how these messages were not being received. I do wish the others would grant forgiveness for this. It is their choice and their consequence. We are only human. But what will they do without a challenge? And they saw her as defiant, aggressive. We will finish later, as it is once again time to go. So she picks up later and says, all right, I have a few more minutes. Tell me more about Charlene during the first body exchange. Charlene is good. Anyone who knows her knows this is true. You needn't mention it. It is known already. Her intentions are fine. She loves and she wants to be loved. I don't know how I should tell you this. Let me say, she has gotten herself into quite a predicament. She wanted to be with Buyaid in the flesh. She imagine being alone with no one understanding the way you think, and the ones you hold close call you names, say you are crazy, but the only craziness is that you care. Then along comes a good friend, the best friend you ever had, and you thought very much alike. You thought about the same things, had the same ideas, knew and loved each other, and had a great communion understanding, but you could only see and hear them. They were behind a glass wall. You enjoyed the time together, but you could not touch, not even a hand, not a hug. It would be like being in a prison, wouldn't it? So along comes an idea to cross the wall. Back to the story. The wall can be crossed. It has been known by not only entering the body of a fetus, but by entering the body of a departing soul. And yes, there is one who is willing to give his body. He is leaving anyway, and rather like the idea of someone else taking over where he left off. So Bob, which I have selected from the names you have given me to call him, as your fine-tuning for names, dates, etc. is not yet complete, has a heart attack and Buyaid revives the body. Now he is here in Texas, and she is there in Tampa, and she goes to see him very excitedly. He's over the wall, where I am, but his condition is severe and takes precedence over his recollections for her. She stays several days, but time is running out, and there is business at home to tend to. She leaves, terribly disappointed and very angry.